Okay. So welcome, everybody. My name is Branden Williams. I want to talk to you today more human element. So one of the great things about this conference and things we get to do is we get to see tons of great technical solutions for things. And vendors love to sell you great technical solutions, I think, as we can tell if you go down to the expo floor. There are other ways that we can get users to do the things that we want them to do versus always putting big technical controls in their way. So we're going to talk about this, the art of the nudge. So first of all, this is, when you think about behavior guidance or manipulation, it's something that we've been doing forever. If you put two sentient beings in a room, somebody is going to eventually going to try to get the other one to do something they want them to do. It could even be a person and an animal, right? Don't kill me, I want to eat you for lunch, right? So how do I get a person to make my preferred choice when presented with a list of options? Not necessarily the one that they want to make, the one I want them to make. Sam Walton knew this. So those of you guys who have ever, if you live in the South, you probably know that's a moon pie. And if you read Sam Walton's book, he used to buy pallets of different types of items and put them on special in the front of his Ben Franklin stores. Sam Walton, if you don't know, is the guy who started Walmart, right? And he figured out pretty quickly that if I put a big pallet of something in front and I put a price tag on it that looks attractive, I'm going to sell a whole lot of that thing, whether it's moon pies or other things. So some simple scenarios to sort of set the stage. Website, if you're on a website shopping or you go into a store, somebody who's approaching you, you have two choices. You can leave with that good or service, or you can walk away and not buy anything. If you're going into a store where there's a person that approaches you, they obviously want you to part ways with money and take the good. On a website, you see the similar thing. So anybody here been shopping online and all of a sudden seen a chatbot pop up and like, hey, can I help you with this product? And of course, nobody's on the other side. It's all an algorithm. But the goal is to try to get you to finish the transaction. And there's been studies that show that it has some ability to increase conversion rates. The other scenario might be, I want you to buy the specific version of my product that pays me the best. So I'm going to nudge my buyer into a particular product or service or bundle mix. And the word bundle ought to be really interesting to you guys. Any of us that buy services and product, there's always some sort of bundle deal that's in there. Whether it's our battle with high-speed internet at our house, and I don't need your TV service, and who has a home phone line anymore? But they want you to bundle everything together so they can really capture that. Perhaps there's ways that will maximize my payoffs. So we're going to assume that people are rational, which is a stretch. But if you apply game theory, maybe the biggest drawback of game theory is that it makes the assumption that the players are all rational. So in the case that I have a way to act that'll maximize my payoffs, that's the way that I will act. There's a talk that I give on the blue-green game. It's a paper by Umble and Umble that talks about how you can game systems like this. And I think even the Wells Fargo example is a great example of how a system that is set up in a way to be gamed can lead to a lot of bad things, not only for those people gaming the system, but for the company itself. So ultimately, we want to play on a bias or guilt to nudge you into that preferred choice. So it could be a conservation thing. When the drought was happening last year here, water was not something that was put on the table. You had to ask for it because they were trying to conserve water and conserve the, you know, those big full cups that you leave the table and don't finish. Or an energy perspective. And I'm going to show you some really cool, I'm going to show you some examples of how this works and it's going to kick in for you. Low calorie meals. So if you're looking for your calorie intake, you're trying to figure out how do I reduce the amount of calories I'm taking in, putting calorie counts on the menu is one way to do that. Frankly, I don't know the difference between a 635 and an 835 calorie meal. I'm sure it's something in the sauce or the cheese. I don't really know. But if I'm trying to be health conscious, maybe I go to the 635 and it's going to steer me that way. And then healthful choices. So I want to nudge you to choose fruit or vegetables as opposed to choosing candy. I suppose it depends on the enterprise, right? Because if I'm a supermarket, I probably have way better margins on candy. So I want to put that candy at eye level in the checkout line. But if I'm a university trying to improve the health of my students in the cafeteria, I put fruit at the eye level in the checkout line. Okay, so what the heck is a nudge anyway? So it's a technique that's been codified from almost 100 years of behavioral economics research in theory. The theory in question is called libertarian paternalism, and you can Google that. By the way, sorry, I forgot to say this. You'll all get a copy of the slides, but they've also have included a resource pack. So at the end of the show, I'll show you how to get the resource pack where you can get links to some of this stuff. Some of the papers I can't share, you need to go to your library, whether it's university or public, but there's some good information that'll help you along the way. So it's codified from almost 100 years of different research. It's a way to take advantage of subtle or even subconscious bias so that somebody is encouraged to choose the path that you want them to choose, even though they may prefer to take a different path. And the definition is sort of changing as different scholars work on this, but the three major tenets I want to talk about today, the nudge should produce a predictable outcome. A nudge is no good if you can't tell what that person, which you know, it's not working the way you want it to work. If they're still choosing their way versus your way, then that's not a very well-constructed choice. Should favor the better or more rational decision. The trick here is that I get to pick what the more rational decision is, not you, right? So we're assuming again that I'm a rational player, again, maybe a stretch, but when I'm making the choice architecture, I get to pick what the rational decision is. So it's my choice, and I'm trying to guide you into that. And the last one is it should exploit the individual's cognitive bias, routines, and habits. If you've ever done any study on the human psyche and how we work, you know, they talk about us having two different brains, right? You have your thinking brain, your rational brain, the one that, you know, can do math and sort of interact with people, and then you have the lizard brain, the fight or flight, right? So I want to tap into lizard brain as much as possible to get you to automatically do it without rational thinking brain saying, why am I walking down this line with an arrow on the floor, right? I just want you to walk down the arrow. Okay, nudge theory is popularized by Richard Thaler and Cass Sunstein. Their book is called Nudge, Improving Decisions About Health, Wealth, and Happiness. What I sort of, you know, I don't want to reduce the book to this little sort of thing, but it's basically a collection in ways of, it's the stupid things that smart people do so that we can function. So I'll give you an example. When we go do Thanksgiving at my parents' house, my mom makes a pumpkin pie that I really like. And it used to be a tradition that we would have pumpkin pie the day after Thanksgiving for breakfast. So super healthy, yes, lots of whipped cream. But it's part of me. Like, we all have those things that remind you of home. So at the end of the dinner on Thanksgiving, when I've wrapped up, we've wrapped up all the leftovers, what do I do so that I remember to take those home? Well, I'll tell you, the stupid thing that I do is I get my car keys and I set them on top of the pie in the refrigerator. Right, so a rational person might open the fridge and say, why are there car keys in the refrigerator? But the smart person in me said, hey, I know that I can't leave without my car keys. So I have to go back and look for them. I remember I put them on top of the pie in the refrigerator. So in their book, they created this framework that everyone can use. But it is still that thing to sort of trick you. It's about a personal help, help book. To get you to choose the path that they want that you want to choose, but do it subconsciously, and it's in use in both private and public enterprise and policy. So if you look for different rules on tax laws and other types of things, you can start to see where somebody is trying to nudge corporations or individuals into a certain behavior or response. An example of this might be the payment network's EMV liability shift. I think it's a great example just because it sort of illustrates the problem. So several years ago, payment brands wanted to get people to upgrade to chip, right? Because Magstripe is static, it can be counterfeited. It's not just a great technology. If we go chip, it allows us to do a lot of other interesting things. I don't work for the card brands. But this is the commentary that was happening in the industry at the time. But it's a very large problem. It's a multi-billion dollar problem because all of you cardholders have multiple cards in your wallet. And each one goes from about $1 to replace to about $5 to replace. So issuers are spending a lot of money to put that plastic with the chip in your pocket. On the other hand, you have merchants who, if you've ever worked with a merchant or you've seen how, go to your dry cleaners and they've got this old crusty terminal that somehow still works. If as long as that cash register drawer opens and the card is accepted, you never replace that thing. So I've got an expensive $350 to $700 piece of machinery that I have to convince a small businessman to buy or a large corporation to roll it up in multiple stores. So what they did is they said, okay, we want everybody to upgrade to chip. If both sides of the transaction are presenting either both have chip or both have magstripe, then our chargeback rules are going to be identical to the way they are today. However, if one of the parties is either chip capable in the terminal or puts a chip in the card, the other party accepts all the chargeback risk. So it's a carrot and stick scenario. So if I'm a business that has a lot of chargebacks, for example, a grocery store, why grocery stores? Because right when you walk in, you see that huge kiosk full of gift cards. And that's a very fraud heavy part of a grocery store. So if I have a lot of chargebacks, I want to make sure that I have those terminals rolled out because it will help me in a chargeback battle if the issuer doesn't have the chip. So I'm sure nobody here thought they would come into RSA on the first big day and see a picture of a men's urinal up on the screen. This is a nudge that is created in the Amsterdam airport. If you guys ever go to the Amsterdam airport, you can see this for yourself. That is not actually a fly. That is painted on there. It's to keep the liquid in the commode and not on the ground. So without going into a lot of things, if you have boys or you are a boy, you know exactly what you're going to do there. You're going to aim for it. Subtle nudge. It doesn't say, please keep it in the toilet. They just put a target for you. So I want to go through some other nudges. This one was from a friend of mine who booked a ticket on American Airlines, and I found this to be just unbelievably perfect on how this one is created. So if you look there, you'll see you've purchased your, you're about to purchase your ticket, and they say, hey, wait a minute, how about some trip insurance? What happens if you have a problem, you have to cancel, like you're buying a non-refundable ticket? Well, look at that, 67,482 other people bought that trip insurance in the last 7 days. Let's assume that number's correct. That's pretty compelling. Not only that, it's in green, and green means good. Okay? Now next, I have to select either yes or no. Do you guys see the no button up there? You gotta scroll. But before I scroll, look, it's recommended. It's 3240. There's a green check mark. That means good. And it's recommended. Awesome. I really should use that trip insurance. I found this to be a fascinating nudge that 67,482 American Airlines customers also agreed with that. Now here's another one. Everyone here knows this one because almost everybody here stayed in a hotel last night or will stay in a hotel or has stayed in a hotel in their lifetime. So the one that's on the left is from a hotel called The Wit, and the text says, most of the witty travelers who stay in this room reuse their towels at least once during their stay. So I know it's a play on the words, The Wit, but I feel like I'm a witty guy. So I should probably reuse my towel because I want to identify with other witty people. Then they'll tell you, they'll apply to the conservationist in me and say, last year there was a savings of over 72 gallons of water, 39 barrels of oil, and prevented nearly 480 gallons of detergent from being released into the environment. Well, all that stuff sounds bad. So if I save the towel, maybe I help to save the environment. What, of course, they don't put in there as well is, oh, this also helps our bottom line, right? Because now we don't have to pay as much per stay. For those of us that are Marriott customers, they have a similar version of this where they say, hey, if you don't want to have the maid come in and clean your room, we'll give you 500 points per day. That's like free money for them. So the one on the right, which I think is actually kind of funny, I'm not sure why the percent is in front of the 75, but they say 75% of guests in this hotel usually use their towels more than once. Again, assuming the number's correct, I'm probably one of the 75%. I'm in the majority. I want to be part of the majority, maybe. So I'll go ahead and reuse my towel. This next one, I just thought this was a really funny example because we were walking down the street in Hollywood Beach, my family and I, and this lady just walks the other way. It's not a picture of her. It's just a general catalog thing. But she walks the other way with this shirt on. And it sort of made me smile, right? Cool people smile. Well, I'm a cool person. Yeah. It's a subtle playing on those biases. Now here's another one that's an example of a nudge for good. So I'd like to think that this is somebody who is really concerned about the health of our citizens. And so what they say is, hey, did you know you can add spinach to this at no charge? So you think about that first and say, okay, well, that seems like an effort of goodwill. If it's at a university, like a campus cafeteria, then all right, we're promoting healthy behaviors in our students. But then I started thinking about it a little bit differently this morning. I said, okay, well, wait a minute. A sandwich can only hold so much stuff. So if I get to the end and I'm like, oh, I could add spinach in there. And if I frequent this place, maybe I remember, oh, I get free spinach. So I'm going to put less of the other stuff in there. Spinach might be a super low-cost ingredient that could displace some of the higher-cost ingredients. Maybe. Now, there's another. The next example is an example of what I'm calling an evil nudge, and I'm calling it that way, just sort of tongue-in-cheek. But there was a nudge that was created in the fast food industry that did a lot to add to the amount of calories that somebody would consume when they go through there. There's actually two of them. So the first one is, do you want fries with that? At one point, French fries were the highest margin item in a fast food restaurant's the things on their menu. So adding fries means I get to charge you 89 cents for just a tiny little bit of cost. Now the other one was what? The supersize. You want to supersize it for an additional 39 cents. Of course I do. That seems like a great deal, right? I put the choice in front of you. Okay. So the next choice I'm going to show you is about decoys. And I'm going to talk about this in a couple different ways. So the first way I want to talk about it, since we're already talking about food and those fries look really good, is in a menu at a restaurant. So as you guys are eating here, and if you get to go to a nice restaurant, see if you can pick out the decoy item on the menu. The decoy item is there to make other items look good, and it's not something that they would expect everybody to buy. An example, the Chateaubriand is $159 for two. But you could buy a nice 8-ounce filet for $49. That 8-ounce filet doesn't look too bad anymore compared to $159 Chateaubriand, however good it might be. And they will sell that, but they're not going to sell as much. They're trying to make that second choice look really attractive. Okay. Now, of all of the people in the world that would create, using this theory, this economic theory, to create a nudge, you would expect it to come from the economists. And they did this brilliantly. So this is the two options that they had originally when you look at how to subscribe to The Economist. I can buy the online subscription for $59, or I can get them both for $125. But what if I just wanted the print one? Why aren't you unbundling that and selling me the print one for $79? Well, what they did instead is they made the print subscription the same price as TheEconomist.com plus the print subscription. I am very certain that they sold some in the middle, but the vast majority of people picked the one on the right. Okay, so what? Why should we care? Well, we should care because nudges happen all around us, all the time. And if you learn which ones are attacking your lizard brain to make you subconsciously do things, then you can see how they were architected and what made them so effective. And you can leverage that in your own information security world. They are mostly free. I put free in there. Mostly free, okay? So yes, there are some things you may have to do that wouldn't exactly be 100% free. But they're way cheaper than buying a big technical solution to a problem. And becoming a better choice architect will help improve your security's functions performance directly by reducing risk. And I'll show you how. Okay, some methods for nudging. I did really good on time. Okay, so the first thing we talk about is simplification and framing. So I want to make the information more straightforward and easier to process. Or framing is going to be phrasing of the information to activate the values or attitudes, lizard brain, of the target. You notice how we're putting the word target in here? That's intentional. So simplification and framing could be something as simple as altering a menu item. We talked about calorie counts beforehand. Like I said, I don't know the difference between one sauce and the next. I don't study food. I don't know that. I love food. I love to eat food. But I tend to prefer, if I know I'm not going to have a super active day, like maybe let's go with the lower calorie item versus the higher calorie item. So maybe that lower calorie item is actually a higher margin item. But it's going to get me every time. I'm probably going to pick it. Changes to the physical environment to guide your target to one choice over another. You guys have probably seen this in airports, hotels, large stores, malls. If you've ever looked and seen an arrow on the ground and subtly started following it, that is a change to the physical environment to get you to do something that I want you to do. Maybe I'm guiding you towards something that's helpful to you, or probably more likely, I'm guiding you to something that's helpful towards me. Changes to the default policy such that the standard choice is the one that you want them to make. Remember, I'm the choice architect, so I get to pick what I want the default policy to be. A clear example of this in the, I want to say it was the late 90s, early 2000s, companies started making a change to how 401k worked. 401k is your investment account, retirement account here in the US, where you can invest dollars and let it grow. And it's supposed to supplement your Social Security, if that even exists by the time guys like me need it. So the default policy was always, you have to fill out all these freaking papers and do all this work, and it has to be signed, and you got to do all this other stuff. And then like 2 months later, maybe we'll open an account for you and start investing. So I worked for a couple companies where they did it the opposite way. They said, you're automatically enrolled. We're automatically opening an account. These are the levels that we're going to invest for you. And if you want to change that, then here's the form to do that. And by the way, you have to opt out. So if you don't want it, you fill out the form. It's not easy. And then you have to mark that you're opting out and taking all this responsibility for your future. So that one to me, it sticks, especially as we talked to, was talking to a colleague today actually, and they were talking about how friction in a transaction is one easy way to get that transaction not to work. Whether I'm trying to enroll you to sign up for a credit card, or I'm trying to get you to purchase something. The example that he had is one large retailer, they have discovered that they let their tokens expire after 7 days on their mobile app. And if somebody responds to the ad that they get or a push notification and starts adding stuff into their cart and hits that you need to sign in again, that they dump out and go to Amazon, or they abandon the cart. So making it as frictionless as possible, changing the default policy, which also, by the way, could get you in legal trouble, so you should talk to your lawyers before you do it, but change the default policy. And the last one is the use of social norms, leveraging peer pressure. It's not just the after-school special. It's a real thing, and it will make people change or make behaviors in a certain way. If you guys have not seen the Netflix special called The Push, I would highly recommend that you download it and watch it on your way back. It's a fascinating exploration on the human psyche and how if I get you to sort of violate certain social norms or break certain rules, that I can ultimately get to the point where I'm going to present you with a problem that is going to force you to make a decision to push somebody off of a building to their death. It's fascinating. Okay, so now what we're going to do, this is the framework that I put together for you. We're just taking these steps together. We're going to choose a problem that you're trying to solve. We're going to choose the nudge method, and then we're going to architect the nudge, and we've got some examples here. So the first one, I've got four problems here that I think are relevant for us as security people. And actually, I have another study I'm going to pull up here in a second. So the first one is people printing out confidential information and leaving on their desk while they go to lunch. Would we agree that that's a problem? I think it's a problem. I think the big challenge for most organizations is once it hits that printed medium, I lose control over it. I put digital controls in place that prevent me from sending it out through an email to my personal email address or to a file share somewhere. But if somebody takes it away and takes it in their briefcase and then uses their other trusty device and digitizes it that way, I've totally lost control of that information. So printing is a very real problem. And printers are a problem too, by the way. Next one, leaving a workstation unlocked when you go to the break room. In the old days, you know, the jokesters would always run up there and send an email to your boss saying, I think you smell, and you know, other stuff like that. I think if you do that now, you might get fired using somebody else's credential in that way, because there's probably a policy against it. But leaving a workstation unlocked is a real problem, because now that person is gone. Someone else is taking their rights and their authority to do things, access information, change things on their behalf. That's another real security problem. The next one is emailing confidential information to someone not authorized to view it. That's a sticky one, right? It's not just the reply all and you said something you weren't supposed to say, right? It could be that somebody in HR actually sends that one spreadsheet for the group that's got everybody's salaries on it, and that huge storm of badness that happens. Or maybe even worse, somebody inside the company sends customer A's data via email to customer B. That's a pretty bad one. And the last one is stopping people from clicking on a bad link that causes malware to be installed. Like, this is such a real problem that how many vendors on the floor claim to solve this problem? a lot. There's a whole cottage industry that has stood up around this exact problem, stopping people from clicking on a link. So would we all agree that these are all real information security problems? I think so. Would we also agree that there are technical solutions to every single one of these that could be extremely expensive? So the one that you may be drawing a blank on is on that first one. Let's get like real Hollywood for a second. And we put cameras everywhere around the office, and we hook up, what are the two words? Artificial intelligence and machine learning, right? To the video feeds. And then we track the document as it leaves, and then if they try to cross an egress point, then you know that's when all the alarms go off and you know bad things happen, right? So technically you could do that. I can't imagine the expense, not only from a legal defense fund that your employees are gonna start revolting, but just putting all that stuff in there, considering most of that stuff's vaporware anyway. Okay. So then we're gonna choose our method. We already saw these, but since we talked about those four problems, I just wanna reinforce that these are our methods. So we're gonna simplify and frame, make the information more straightforward and easier to process, and use phrasing of information to activate those values and attitudes of the target, the lizard brain. The next one is changes to the physical environment to guide your target to take one choice over another. Changes to the default policy, such that the standard choice is the one that I want them to choose, not the one that they want to choose. And the last one is use of social norms to leverage peer pressure to cause your target to choose the preferred option. So let's architect the nudge. From the social norms, prompt users to not print, remind them that paper breaches hurt too, and make them click I acknowledge to continue. Maybe find a little kitten meme or a puppy meme or something to throw up there so they go, oh, yeah, okay, I got you, right? We've got some other more effective, potentially, ways, but that could be one, right? Next one, change the physical environment. So posters outside cubes. Remember, this is the one of locking workstations. Posters outside cubes reminding people to lock their workstation. Did you lock your workstation on your way to the break room, to lunch, whatever it is? Cool people lock their workstations. People that get the best bonuses and raises during review period lock their workstations. Change the default policy. Instead of automatically sending the email, using a keyword search to alert the sender that email may contain confidential information to check the recipient. So many companies I've seen recently, I've worked for a couple that do this, where if I send an email and the address is outside the company, it pops up a little box and it says, hey, by the way, did you realize this is going outside the company? Here are the domains outside the company that you're trying to send this to. That's a very effective catch. Because if you fat figured something and you had an autocomplete and all of a sudden you got an external email when you meant to send it internally, thank goodness that thing is there to stop me. Wait, and it makes you click yes or no. So the majority of the email that I send internal. So I have to hit that button. Like the email doesn't send and Outlook sits there and hangs and dings at you because it's not a smart application until I click the button that says, okay, no, this is okay to go, or no, I did not mean to do that. Okay, and then framing. So this is the clicking the link from outside the company. Alert the user that the email is external and they should not click it. So putting external in the subject, putting words at the top of the email that say, hey, this is an external email before it gets delivered to their inbox. There's another sort of interesting problem that this creates though. So for those of you that test your employees and phish them, the phishing emails now are really easy to spot because they don't have the external tag on them. Now, if you get really crafty and you put the external tag on them, then it's a little bit harder. But trying to frame the information to them and show them, hey, this is something that is could be dangerous because it's outside your company. Okay, so there's a study. I'm gonna pull up this study real quick. I wrote it down because I would not remember all these things. These guys, Cancane, Buckley, and DeRosso, did an experiment looking at how do I have users create better passwords. Like, we can have a whole separate debate on passwords and how awful they are. That's not the scope for today. But what they were trying to do is, in their mind, create things that had better passwords, better password construction. They use five methods. They use an incentive, a reward or punishment, which is an economic value. So one of the things I didn't talk about is Cass Sunstein and Richard Thaler say that a nudge should not have an economic impact for it to truly be a nudge, meaning that it doesn't favor me, the person making the choice, one way or the other economically, no matter what I do. Other choice architects have said, no, that's an absolute thing you have to include, and it does make a big difference. So this would be an incentive. The next one was a norm, saying behavior strongly is influenced by other socially acceptable behaviors. The default policy following preset options, our system will assign you a password and it's going to expire it and reset it for you. Salience, which is the, hey, hackers are trying to hack your stuff right now, all the time. So choose something that's secure so they don't hack this one. And then the last one is ego, playing to the ego. Smart people choose a good password. Cool people choose a good password. And here's how you do that. And they actually found that the salience one was the one that created the most compliance by sort of creating that scare threatscape, which kind of sad, but it's the way that particular study came out. I'm gonna do it on time. Okay. So here's some examples. Does anybody here love getting those local admin requests? I need local admin. Then you start to ask why they need local admin. Well, because I want to install this program on my computer. Well, is that something you needed? I needed to do my job. When do you need Spotify to do your job exactly? Nothing at Spotify, but use your phone, right? Like a normal person. So local admin requests. So what could we do to try to curb people and have them not want to make that request? Well, A, we could make the documentation requirement and approval process really onerous. It's a 4-page form you have to fill out. Oh, by the way, it requires CEO approval. That might be a real quick way to stop that. We could extend the SLA. Guys, I'm so sorry. I know you're submitting this form right now. We have a 6-month backlog trying to go. We have one guy. I know it's stupid, but we just have one guy and he's going through all these requests. It's not even gonna be 6 months until I can look at this. Okay, well, I don't like that. So, or requiring a charge code. So this is kind of a fun thing where you could say, hey, I'll do this for you, but I have to do all this investigation and paperwork. So I need your resource center, your cost center, so I can charge $10,000 to that because I'm supposed to be a recoverable resource doing services back to you. Also sounds kind of scary, right? So what about an alternative? I could offer a 1-hour discovery session for free where a colleague can help the user do their job without local admin. So most of the time it's not doing your job, it's I need a convenience that I have in my personal world that I want at work. But there are some instances where people are saying, no, I need it to do my job because they were never taught another way. So I would argue that in the last 10 years, maybe even 15 years of my career, I've spent a significant amount of time doing exactly that. Going through and watching how people work and looking at the process that they follow and figuring out creative ways where they can do their job with minimal impact, but not having, for example, social security numbers sitting in Excel spreadsheets, which is, you know, a big problem. Okay, so that's a default policy change and changes to the physical environment. Now, badge out policy, this one's kind of interesting, right? So I worked for a place, one job, that had a badge out policy to prevent tailgating. So meaning that I could use my badge at the door to get in, but if I forgot to hit that on the way out, my badge would not let me back in because the badge is supposed to be inside, right? So if you have a tailgating problem, this could be one way to curb that. Or you have people that are forgetting their badges, I'll just follow behind somebody else. So a side benefit, which is a little bit Orwellian, maybe the right word, is that we can get data understanding a day in the life of our employees, which could be good or bad, right? It gets bad when you're like, oh, look at this guy. He goes out that door 17 times during the day. What is he doing? Or people that show up at 9:30 and leave at 4 and say, no, I'm working a full-time job. Okay. Now, reducing waste or risk via printing. So charge back users for pages printed. Pop up a message, hey, looks like you have, 60 copies of this 200-page document, and I'm going to charge you 10 cents a page back to your call center. Or maybe you just create a wall of shame. Look at Jenkins. Look at all the printing that Jenkins does. Everyone else is really small, but Jenkins is way over to the right. This is the one time where being over to the right is a bad thing, right? Or, hey, I'm going to make you type a 100-word essay on why you need to print. That might be the solution right there. Nobody would print everything ever again, right? You would bring your laptop or a tablet and say, look, we're gonna go to this document here. Or, I mean, I haven't been in a conference room in the last 10 years that didn't have the ability to present something on a screen. The result should be decreased printing of sensitive, but really all data, right? And it could lead to decreased information leakage from hard copies being left or lost. It's a default policy change. Some more printed examples, a sign on a conference room or a meeting room. That's if you don't already have it, right? So remember not to leave any presentation material behind. If no longer required, ensure it's disposed of properly in shredding bins. So I'm framing the information. Oh yeah, there could be sensitive information in here. I should put that in the appropriate place. All good corporate employees put things in the shred bins. Apply to the other side of that as well. Workstation locking. You know, the signs on the way. Have you locked your workstation? Social norms. Okay. So now we're going to do a quick review. We made it to the end. I've got some time for questions, and I've got the instructions to get the presentation and the resource kit that I prepared for you all. So as we talked about, nudges can be used as a cheap or free security control that encourages your fellow employees or maybe even your customers to choose the secure pathway as you define what that secure pathway is, not what they define. So nudge should do three things. It should produce a predictable outcome, because if it's not predictable, it's not very effective or very good. It should favor the better or more rational decision. Again, I get to pick because I'm the choice architect, or you guys get to pick as now deputy choice architects. And it should exploit the individual's cognitive bias, routines, and habits. Tap into lizard brain. In fact, one of my favorite examples of lizard brain, if you guys watch The Office and you remember the experiment where Jim was rebooting his computer and every time the sound happened, he offered Dwight an Altoid. And the one time he rebooted his computer and Dwight just held his hand out and he's like, what are you doing? So lizard brain, it can be fun for pranking too, right? And it should leverage the simplification and framing of data. Make it easy to understand. Changes to the physical environment so that I'm guiding you physically to the choice I want you to make. It could be a change to the default policy so that you are now forced to choose. If you want to change or do something different, you have to make that selection as opposed to just going in the friction-free way of I'm deciding what you need to do. And the last one is use of social norms. Only cool people or all cool people are going to lock their workstations. Only the best people that make the biggest raises don't print, right? So applying what you learned today, in the next week, just think about 3 to 5 human security problems that are worth solving. Not every problem is worth solving. We only have so many resources. I was talking to somebody about the fun of information security, and it's very similar, and comparison has been made before. It's like a game of Risk. You were intentionally not given enough resources to dominate everything. You have to make strategic choices and selections, and we have the same thing. So identify 3 to 5 human problems that are worth solving. And then on the next one, pick 2 of those problems and really fully define and understand it. When I was going through my last academic run, I went to this conference of a bunch of academics in management. So it's a thrilling conference, as you can imagine. And one of the guys said, hey, the difference between a practitioner scholar and a straight scholar is that scholars want to understand problems while practitioners want to solve them. So I think we as practitioners rely on our backgrounds and sometimes jump in faster without really fully understanding the problem or how to solve it and how to frame it. So using things like the Socratic method of problem solving and Bloom's taxonomy, which are 2 academic terms, but they are worth looking through and really helping to understand and define a problem before you go tackle it. And then architect that nudge to have humans correct their own behavior. Somebody asked me the other day, we were talking about nudges, and said, can you over-nudge somebody? Yes. Yeah. So be careful and thoughtful and creative on how you do it. I mean, at some point, if every square inch of the hallway is covered with another information security poster, you're just going to ignore the fancy new wallpaper and keep walking to where you need to walk. So within 6 months, you should evaluate the results of your nudge and iterate, right? We're all DevOps and Agile, and that's the way to go now. So if it's not working, go fix it or scrap it and go try something different. And then choose another problem to solve, as you guys are all now deputy choice architects. So for questions, step up to the mics, I think. They're right over there on those sides of the room. If you want to learn more, you can send a blank email to b@sendyourslides.com. with the subject RSAC2019. What that's gonna do is it's gonna send you 2 emails. The first one is gonna be an email that says, thank you for coming, and here's the link to the toolkit that has all the information that I presented today, as well as some other things that might be useful to you. And the second thing is it will ask you if you want to subscribe to a mailing list. The default policy is that no, you don't. So you have to make the selection to choose. What you get there is, you know, if I do talks like this, I usually send the resource kit out to the larger list. You can also send me tweets. It's fun. Fine, I don't do it too often, but you can, and you can visit my blog for their content. So at that point, I'll pause for any questions. Y'all aren't sleeping, are you? Here we go.
What does the research say on the psychological effect of people knowing they are being nudged versus not? Maybe it's like my old school hippie 60s parents, but anytime I see that, oh, we want you to do this, I'm like, down with the man, I'm going the other direction.
I like that. I like you. Yes. So there's been studies that show when humans know that they're being studied, that they behave differently. It's exactly what you're talking about, right? Some very famous studies about altering the levels of lighting in a factory. And it didn't matter what they do, productivity always went up, right? Because they saw that they were being studied and messed with. So research now, you have to use sort of trickery so that people don't realize they're being researched. If your choice, and you're architecting a choice, and it's so clear to the person that what you're trying to do is not, because that what are you doing at that point, right? You're attacking rational thought brain. That's a losing battle. You want to attack lizard brain, right? So if that's happening and you see people like, what are these guys doing? I mean, clearly, why don't they just tell us to choose this and I'll just do it that way? Why do you have to make this whole production about all this stuff? Then you've been too grandiose. Get simpler. An arrow on a floor, a fly on a toilet. Super simple. Great question. Any other questions? Okay, I think that's it. You want 5 minutes back? We're good? All right, thanks everybody.
That was an awesome session, Brandon. Thank you very much. Thanks very much, everybody. Thank you. Bye-bye.